So, it is my special privilege to introduce our keynote presenter today, Linda Rudolph. Linda leads the Center for Climate Change and Health at the Public Health Institute. She works with people across a broad spectrum of public health activities to incorporate health considerations into climate change action and climate change considerations into work to promote healthy communities of health equity. I told my kids that you were going to be here today, and I read a little bit of this to them, and they're dying to meet you. So that's a little sideline that I'll be talking to you about later. Before her appointment at PHI, Dr. Rudolph served as the Deputy Director of the California Department of Public Health Center for Chronic Disease Prevention and Public Health, and the Health Officer and Public Health Director for the City of Berkeley, California. She served as the Chief Medical Officer for Medi-Cal Managed Care. She received her doctorate in medicine and clinical training in pediatrics and emergency medicine from the University of California at San Francisco, and her master's in public health from the University of California at Berkeley. In addition to her keynote address, and you'll probably want to mark this on your calendars, Dr. Rudolph will be presenting a session not to be missed called Health in All Policies, a Framework for Advancing Equity. Please welcome Dr. Linda Rudolph.
What I'm going to talk about today while I'm doing this, I was thinking about how when I was a small kid, I went to the planetarium. And when I came home from the planetarium, I lay in my bed and I thought about me in my bed, and then I thought about me in my house, and then I thought about me on my block, and me in my city, and my city in the United States, and then I thought about the United States and the world, and then I thought about what I'd seen at the planetarium, and I thought about, you know, me in this huge, huge universe. So what I'm going to try and do today is sort of walk out a little bit from what we do in healthcare all the time, and think about a couple of really, really big issues that we're confronting. We're spending a lot of money in the United States on healthcare. I don't need to tell you that. There's been a slight slowing in the rate of growth of spending, but we're still spending a lot. But we're not getting as much value from those healthcare dollars as we would like. In 1980, the U.S. ranked 14th among industrialized countries in life expectancy at birth, but by 2003, we slipped to 23rd place, and that number hasn't really improved since then. Our leading causes of death are chronic disease, heart disease, cancer, stroke. We know that what's contributing to those chronic disease deaths, and about 80% of our healthcare dollars is spent on chronic disease, is largely our behavioral patterns. And if you look at the actual causes of death, three behaviors cause about 70 to 75% of deaths. That's tobacco, poor diet, and physical inactivity, and alcohol consumption's in there too. So what's going on? Why is Jason sick? He has an infection in his leg. Why does he have an infection in his leg? He has an infection in his leg because he was playing in the junkyard near his house and fell down and got a cut on his leg and got infected. Why was he playing in the junkyard? Well, he was playing in the junkyard because there's no playgrounds near his house, and all the kids play there. They don't have any other place to play in. Why does he live in a neighborhood without a playground? Well, he lives in a neighborhood without a playground because One of his parents is disabled, and the other one has a really low-wage job, and they just can't afford to live anyplace else. But why can't they afford to live anyplace else? Jason suffers because of the social determinants of health. We know that health outcomes are directly related to education. Moms with lower education have higher infant mortality in their children. Adults with higher, lower education report poorer health. We know our health outcomes are directly related to race, with African Americans consistently having the lowest life expectancies. We know that health outcomes and life expectancy are directly related to income. The lower the income, regardless of what the race or ethnicity, and regardless of what part of the country, the worse health outcomes. We know that health outcomes are inversely related, in other words, worse health outcomes with greater inequity, whether you look at it by country, or look at it by state, or look at it within states. So the greater the level of inequity, the lower the life expectancy, the higher the infant mortality, the more homicides, the more teenage births, the more obesity, the more mental illness. And we know that health outcomes are greatly influenced by our physical environments, our services environments, our working environments, our economic environments, and our social environments. And that people can't easily change their behaviors when there's so many forces in those environments that conspire against health. We also know that those environments aren't equitably distributed. We all know that there's some neighborhoods that have nice parks, nice farmers markets, nice bicycle lanes, and others, like where Jason lived, that have lousy housing, lousy schools, lots of liquor stores, lots of convenience stores, are near freeways, and don't have trees or playgrounds. And that's why we see these really stark differences in life expectancy and life outcomes, which are the preventable differences that are the result of the systematic and unjust distribution of the social determinants or conditions that support health. I live in Oakland, where the difference in life expectancy between those that live in West Oakland and those that live in Berkeley Hills is over 10 years. In San Francisco, the difference between Bayview, Hunters Point, and Russian Hill is 14 years. Mind you, that's less than 7 miles apart. You see it in Washington, D.C., take a metro, get to different life expectancies. And we see these differences in the Pacific Northwest as well, with differences in social determinants of health. So what's really going on here is that our living conditions are shaping both our direct health risks and exposures, like exposure to air pollution or other bad things in our environment, and those are also shaping our health behaviors, and that's what's leading to these health inequities. I want to talk a little bit just as an example about one. You all are familiar with what the impacts are of hunger and food insecurity on patients and their health. We know that in children, food insecurity is associated with increased hospitalizations, higher rates of obesity and overweight, and when there's frank hunger, with cognitive and social, emotional, behavioral problems. In adults, we see overweight and poor adult health status associated with food insecurity. In Massachusetts, a project called Project Bread trained clinicians across the state to identify people with food insecurity and raise awareness about the availability of a food source hotline that connect people to resources to assist them with food insecurity. And they found that about 11% of families that were screened were positive for food insecurity. The rate of food insecurity in Oregon, by the way, is about 15%. And we know that if you ask about food insecurity with even one question, a simple question. Was there any day in the past month when you or anyone in your family went hungry because you did not have enough money for food, that you will find a lot of patients with food insecurity? And that offers an opportunity to refer them to senior meals programs, to local food pantries, to the WIC program, to SNAP, to emergency food programs. But I want you to think about, why do we have food insecurity? Why are so many people that we see in our clinic suffering from food insecurity? It's not because we don't have enough food in the United States. It's really a multi-causal problem. It's partly related to poverty. That's partly related to unemployment. It's related to low-wage jobs. It's related to the fact that people live in bad food environments, in part because there's been neighborhood disinvestment. And when they live in those neighborhoods, there's no transportation to get to a better food retail source. It's related to the fact that people are spending so much money on housing that they don't have enough money to buy food. It's related to the fact that we spend a lot of money in this country subsidizing corn and soy instead of subsidizing fruits and vegetables. So if you look at this list of what's contributing to food insecurity and poor diets, where's public health and health care? We're not really there. We've got community development, we've got agriculture, we've got transportation, we've got zoning, we've got housing. So that leads one to think that if we really want to impact health, and food insecurity is just one example of how these environments lead to poor health outcomes and poor health choices, we need a new approach. Our current decision-making is very siloed. It's focused on a single goal or mandate. It's short-term in orientation. It doesn't really allow us to address these wicked problems like poverty and health inequities. We all have a role to play in creating healthy communities. And that's really the concept behind health and all policies, that the environments in which people live, work, learn, and play impact our health, and that those environments are largely shaped by agencies that are not health agencies, either public health agencies or healthcare agencies, and that we in health need to think about how we can get people in these other agencies to think more about the health impacts of the decisions that they make so that we can improve the environments in which patients live in communities so that they can make better choices every day and have better health outcomes. Health and all policies is a collaborative approach to improving the well-being of all people by incorporating health into decision-making across sectors and policy areas. It's trying to get at the why, at the causes of the causes that can influence to improve health. In California, in 2010, Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger, on the eve of a childhood obesity summit with President Clinton, which was a very interesting conversation, issued an executive order establishing a health and all policies task force. And I think this was the first time in the United States that health and all policies actually had a formal home. But the concept has spread a lot, and I want to just acknowledge Wayne County, where the person whose name I already forgot was from, but Lane County is one of the places in Oregon that's really in the forefront of health and all policies now, and I've been connecting Lane County with some counties in California that I've been working with so that they can talk about what they're doing. This task force brought together about 19 different state agencies from all across state government and really started looking at what is a healthy community, and I'll talk more about this tomorrow, that's my plug. And we started out by setting some aspirational goals. So just for example, our aspirational goal on food was that all California residents have access to healthy, affordable foods at school, at work, and in their neighborhoods. We did a report that tried to figure out what can state government do to get closer to these goals. So, for example, we said we could work at the state level to promote active transportation, walking, biking, and public transit, because the physical activity that you get with active transportation is so important in meeting daily physical activity guidelines. We said we could work to plant trees in tree-poor neighborhoods and increase access to healthy foods with school and community gardens. We said that we could encourage and expand the availability of affordable and locally grown produce through farm-to-fork policies. And in fact, the Departments of Education, Food and Agriculture, and Public Health established jointly a farm-to-fork compass that's really focusing on getting local fresh produce to schools all over California. And also, we set up a task force to look at whether or not agencies in California, the biggest of which is the Department of Corrections, can actually spend their food dollars on healthy eating and sustainable local food purchases. Well, let's step back even from what goes on in our neighborhoods and look at what we know about the healthiness of both the food that we produce and the food, how we grow it. We know that we have a very industrialized food production system in the United States. We use a lot of synthetic nitrogen-based fertilizers. Those fertilizers in the Midwest end up running down the Mississippi River into the Gulf of Mexico and creating a giant dead zone where nothing grows. There's no fish, there's no algae, there's no life forms. It's basically dead. In California and other agricultural areas, the runoff from nitrogen fertilizer leads to very significant nitrate contamination in groundwater wells, meaning that water in the ground is no longer accessible to people to drink without very expensive treatment. We also know that because we subsidize corn and soy, the vast majority of which goes to feeding animals in the United States, we eat a lot of meat because it's very cheap. We eat about four times as much meat in the United States as is recommended, and you can just see in this how much we eat compared to the rest of the world. But as other countries develop and get bigger middle classes, they are moving toward us in terms of meat consumption. Well, meat consumption isn't that great for health. We know it's associated with cardiovascular disease and some cancers. And we also know that industrialized animal production for meat, which relies on a lot of antibiotics because of the risks of infection in animals that are grown in confined spaces very, very close to each other, is one of the primary contributors to antibiotic resistance in the United States. And I'm sure you're all familiar with what the implications of that are in our communities. We also know that industrialized meat production leads to a lot of air pollution with ammonia and dusts in areas around these concentrated animal feeding operations. And we know that cows produce a lot of methane, and that increasingly deforestation in the tropical rainforests is because people are displacing forests for growing corn and soy, as well as other crops like palm oil. So meat, because of that methane production, is a big contributor to greenhouse gases. Here you can see the life cycle greenhouse gas emissions of meat and dairy on the left side, and other high-protein foods like lentils or tofu on the right side of the chart. I'm not against meat. This is me and my son. He is a meat farmer. He's a rancher growing chickens and pigs on a ranch in Southern California, but not in a concentrated animal feeding operation. And if we all grew the kind of meat that he grows, we would not be able to eat nearly as much. As we all ate kind of pinky gross, we would not be able to eat nearly as much of it as we do, and we would be eating more sustainably grown meat that also actually has the potential for sequestering carbon in soils. So just like before, you saw this health processes of living conditions leading to health behaviors and health risks and health inequities, there's a very similar process, an analogous process that's going on with greenhouse gas emissions. It's not just what we eat, it's also how we drive, where we drive, how much we drive, how we get around, how we jet around the world to places like here, what kind of energy we use, how much energy we use, how much we consume. All of these things contribute to greenhouse gas emissions. And those greenhouse gas emissions are acting like a blanket that's trapping heat in the atmosphere and leading to very significant impacts on the global climate, including warming, the loss of glaciers and snowpacks, the rise of sea levels, the acidification of the oceans because the oceans act as a sink for carbon dioxide, and variability, more variability in rainfall. So it's getting wetter in some places and drier in others, and the intensity of storms is increasing. Those five key global climate impacts are leading to local climate impacts. So all along the coast, we're seeing coastal flooding, especially when there's high tides. In Miami now, there's neighborhoods where people are actually checking the tides before they decide when they're going to go in and out of their neighborhoods because they're so predictably flooding on their streets whenever there's a high tide. We're seeing decreased snowpack in the Sierras this year in California. The snowpack is 5% of normal. That's a disaster. We're seeing much more extreme heat as well as higher normal temperatures. And Bruce started off the day by talking about how lovely the weather's been in Portland. That's great. I love heat. But it's scary when we see these changes happening all over the world. It leads to greater length of fire season and more intense wildfires, and it leads to more extreme and more frequent weather events like Hurricane Katrina or Superstorm Sandy, and to drought. And these local climate impacts have big impacts on environments, both social and natural environments. So we're seeing more harmful algal blooms. We're seeing more contamination of food and water. Cholera, for example, really likes warmth, so does salmonella and campylobacter. We're seeing economic losses associated with things like the drought. We're in California, we think that there are going to be thousands of acres that have been fallowed because of the drought. Probably about 15 to 20,000 jobs were lost in 2014, and billions of dollars in crop losses, and that's going to be worse this year because the drought is so persistent. We're seeing changes in the distribution of various kinds of vectors. So again, in California, we now have the Aedes aegypti mosquito, which carries dengue fever and chikungunya fever. Dengue is now endemic in parts of southern Florida. It hasn't been seen there in decades and decades and decades. All of this has health impacts. Not just the direct impacts of heat, illness, and extreme weather, although those are very significant. In the California drought of 2006, there was about 650 excess deaths. And in Europe in 2003, there was about 70,000 excess deaths. But we're also seeing air pollution impacts because rising temperatures are associated with higher levels of ozone. We're seeing more infectious disease. Because of the decline in crop yields, we see this increase in food insecurity, and I'll come back to that. We're seeing more water insecurity, and we're seeing around the world displacement, conflict, and migration. So many there was millions of people internally that were displaced and moved to other parts of the country, and that really exacerbated conflicts over land and ethnic conflicts. And all of this has big stress and mental health impacts. Each of these impacts of climate change has many different kinds of impacts on health. So just as an example, heat. I mentioned that ozone rises with increasing temperatures. Crops are hurt by increasing temperatures. Wildfires are exacerbated by increasing temperatures. Pollen production is increased, and the length of the pollen season is increased as temperatures warm. So there's some parts of the country now where the pollen season is already about a month longer than it was before. I don't know if you're all seeing that. I'm seeing a lot of head nodding heads out there. As the temperature rises, the soil dries out, and that leads to more dust. California, we're having an epidemic of valley fever, probably in part associated with increased dust, and those spores of valley fever are carried in the dust. More wildfires, and the smoke from wildfires can actually travel for about 1,000 miles or more and have very significant impacts on respiratory and cardiovascular health over very long distances. And of course, the more heat there is, the more energy we use. And as long as we're using fossil fuel-based energy, the more energy we use, the more greenhouse gas emissions we're pouring into the atmosphere. This climate change is happening against the backdrop of other environmental impacts that I talked about before, like deforestation or water contamination or air pollution or topsoil depletion. And that's why climate change, along with these other environmental impacts, is literally threatening the systems on which human life depends. It's threatening our air, our water, our food, our shelter, and our security. So climate change is an existential threat to human beings. Just like living conditions impact health inequities, so too does climate change. Because two of the things that make people and communities the most vulnerable to climate change are health status and living conditions. And that's why we see the climate gap. Climate change disproportionately impacts the very young, the very old, people of color, poor people, people that don't have good access to transportation, indigenous peoples, and people that already have chronic illness, and people that work outdoors like farm workers. Farm workers are clearly more vulnerable to heat. People without transportation saw it in Superstorm Sandy and in Katrina. They were the ones that were stuck in their homes when they couldn't evacuate. People that already are living on the edge are more susceptible to the impacts of rising food prices that are associated with declining crop yields. People that are old and sick or very young are more susceptible to the impacts of heat. People that live in already polluted neighborhoods are more susceptible to the impacts of rising ozone levels. So let's come back and talk again about climate change and food insecurity. I mentioned the impacts on snow. In more, as it warms, more water falls as rain than snow. And in many places, here in the Northwest and California, other places around the world, we rely on melting snowpack to provide irrigation for agriculture during the summer months. We know that severe storms increase crop losses. We know that severe storms and flooding lead to more degradation of topsoil and soil erosion that make it harder to grow food. All these things, and drought and heat, and fewer chill hours. So like cherries and stone fruits and nuts all require a number of chill hours, and as the temperature rises, there's fewer chill hours. So for all these reasons, We see declining crop yields, and this is just what's forecast for California's Central Valley. Farmers in Southern California are talking about trying to find land in Washington so that they have some hope of continuing to be able to be farmers, or their kids have some hope of being able to be farmers. Warming temperatures also increase pests, agricultural pests, increase the amount of insect damage, and increase agricultural diseases. And that means that there's going to be more spraying of pesticides and herbicides as people try to contend with these climate impacts on things that damage crops. I talked about the drought. It is incredibly serious. It is related to climate change because the conditions that are creating the drought are related to climate change. And there's no promise that it's going to go away. NASA forecast recently a very high likelihood that unless there's a significant change in the trajectory of our greenhouse gas emissions, there's a high likelihood of mega droughts in the Southwest. Droughts that, including California, that last for many decades. In case you forgot, we can't survive without water. In 2012, the California legislature passed a bill called the Human Right to Water Bill that every human being has the right to safe, clean, affordable, and accessible water, adequate for human consumption, cooking, and sanitary purposes. That seems self-evident. But the fact of the matter is that as groundwater levels have been dropping, and parenthetically, as groundwater levels drop, the contaminants, like all those nitrates, that are in groundwater aquifers get more concentrated. So the water becomes less safe to drink. But there's hundreds of families in disadvantaged, disenfranchised rural areas in California who literally have had their taps run dry with this drought, who are now using bottled water for all of their drinking and household water needs. Increasing levels of carbon dioxide also actually threaten nutrition in a different way, because with rising levels of CO2, you see less protein in many crops, and you also see lower levels of iron and other important micronutrients. So this is particularly an issue in other parts of the world where people are living really on the edge of malnutrition, and they need whatever iron and zinc they can get from the crop-based products that they eat. And climate change also threatens our food distribution systems. This is a picture of barges on the Mississippi River that were hung up for weeks and weeks during the drought, Midwest drought of 2012, when there was millions and millions of dollars of crops that were damaged, just sitting waiting for there to be enough water in the Mississippi that the barges could carry the crops down the river and deliver them to where they were headed. And finally, I mentioned climate change impacts on heat really impact farm workers, and I talked about increased pesticides and job losses. But another thing that's really interesting is that people are forecasting that heat has a big impact on human productivity. So people are forecasting in many parts of the United States where there's going to be times of the year in a couple of decades where the heat is so great that we're going to lose significant productivity because people simply will not be able to adapt to the levels of heat that we're seeing. And that also has economic impacts if we continue to pay people piece rates for what they pick. And I also mentioned the impacts of migration. In the upper left, you see migration during the Dust Bowl. So it has happened here before. And people in the Central Valley are sort of saying, wow, what are we going to do if there's not agriculture in the Central Valley? Where are people going to go? So just to recap, everything is connected. I'm lying in my bed and I'm connected to the bigger universe. Declining crop yields from climate change are going to lead to price increases, which lead to food insecurity, which lead to people eating more cheap, dense-calorie food, which leads to chronic illness, which leads to more health inequities. That's why this year, USDA, in its dietary guidelines, proposed adding a section on sustainability, basically saying a diet higher in plant-based foods, such as vegetables, fruits, whole grains, etc., and lower in calories in animal-based foods is more health-promoting and is associated with less environmental impact than is the current U.S. diet. The average U.S. diet now has a larger environmental impact in terms of increased greenhouse gas emissions, land use, water use, and energy use. And they link these things and propose that we should try and eat a healthier and more sustainable diet. Because those things are linked. If we keep eating what we're eating and producing food the way we're producing it, we're just contributing to this cycle that's going to then have adverse impacts on our food. The meat industry and the commodities industry have gone holistic over this recommendation. Because they have an interest in keeping things the way they are. And the fossil fuel industry has an interest in keeping us hooked on fossil fuel energy. So the fact that we're still so fossil fuel based in how we get around and how we heat our homes and what kind of where we get our electricity from means that we are continuing to put out carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases at an alarming rate. Last week, they announced that carbon dioxide levels are the highest that they've ever been, over 400 parts per million. These are levels that are higher than they've been in millions of years. So human beings did not evolve on a planet that looks the way our planet looks now in terms of carbon dioxide levels. Scientists know that we have a carbon budget. There is a finite amount of carbon that we can put into the atmosphere and still have any hope of remaining below a 2 degree centigrade increase in temperatures over pre-industrial times. And that's the goal that has been set by the world scientists for maintaining, quote, a safe space. Now, note that we're only at about 0.8 degrees centigrade above pre-industrial times now, and we're already seeing very, very significant impacts on climate. So going to 2, okay, it's starting to be a little risky. But we've already used up 2/3 of that budget. And if we keep putting out greenhouse gases at the rate that we're putting them out now, we will basically run through our carbon budget within the next couple of decades. That's why the editor of the British Medical Journal a couple of months ago called on the World Health Organization to recognize that climate change is a health emergency. The worst impacts won't be seen for decades, but the action has to happen now because the greenhouse gases that we're putting into the air now are going to persist for many, many, many years. We do have choices. We have lots of choices. We actually know how to fix this problem. We know how to shift to renewable energy and stop using oil, gas, and coal. We know how to build cities that are friendly for active transportation. We know how to change our diet and change our food production so that it's both healthier and less damaging to the environment. And if we make those changes quickly, we can make a very, very significant difference. On the left, you see average global temperatures with reduction of greenhouse gas emissions now. And on the right, you see what it will look like if we don't make those changes very quickly. A great thing about the changes we need to make is that virtually all of them, not all, but many, have incredible health co-benefits. So just to give you a few ideas about those health co-benefits. We know that if we shift from coal-based electricity to renewable solar and wind energy and hydroelectric and so on, we not only reduce greenhouse gases, we reduce air pollution, we decrease the amount of money that people are spending on fuel, and then we reduce asthma, respiratory disease, cardiovascular disease, and some adverse birth outcomes. If we were able to shift from an average of 4 minutes a day in active transportation to 19 minutes a day, that's not that much. That's 10 minutes each way to and from work. And this data actually comes from Southern California. We see about a 12% reduction in heart disease, a 12% reduction in diabetes, and significant reductions in dementia, breast cancer, osteoporosis, depression. But if we don't do that right, we also see an increase in bicycle and pedestrian accidents. But we don't see those kinds of reductions with anything we do, except maybe the impacts from our tobacco control campaign. So we can do this. And we get about 12-14% reductions just with this modest shift in greenhouse gas emissions. We know that if we change the way we produce food, we can move toward an agroecological system, which is more integrated agriculture that doesn't do giant tracts of monoculture with lots of pesticides and lots of synthetic fertilizer use and lots of antibiotic use. We would reduce pesticide levels, we'd reduce water pollution. And if we really got people to shift their diets, we'd reduce obesity and cardiovascular disease and cancer and diabetes. So, climate change is the defining health challenge of our time. And it's closely related to the health inequities that we're already seeing in our communities, because it will exacerbate those health inequities. We have a choice. We know we can change the way that we move around, the way we eat, and the way we heat and cool and light our homes. And that's why when we're thinking about our policies at a local level, at a state level, at a national level, and at an international level, we need to be thinking about climate and health and equity in everything that we do, because those things are all very, very closely interrelated. So this climate change can seem really overwhelming. And it's pretty easy to just sort of say, like, it's too big, it's too complex, like, I can't make a difference. And there was a period in time when it used to drive me crazy to see somebody like me standing up and talking like this and then saying, so what can you do? Well, you can change your light bulbs. And it's like, I'm sorry. I know that changing my light bulbs is important, but it just doesn't seem commensurate with the magnitude of the challenge. What we need are systems changes, and we need them quickly. We need changes in our agricultural system, in our energy system, in our transportation system, the way we use land. But that can only happen if people like you start making these connections between health and equity and what we're doing to our environment, and do that by talking to people so that we start to build the political will we need to stand up to the fossil fuels industry and others who are trying to perpetuate systems that are damaging our health, increasing inequity, and damaging the planet. Talk to your colleagues, talk to your patients, talk to your communities, talk to decision makers in your communities. Your voice, the health voice, means a lot. When you talk to a local decision maker and explain that you are seeing increases in allergies that are related to climate change, or that you are seeing changes in the rates of diabetes and because of our unhealthy food systems. That matters. When you talk to decision makers about what's happening with asthma in your communities and how important it is to reduce pollution from cars, trucks, and stationary sources, that matters. So you have a voice that has not been heard on these issues that is absolutely critical. Go out and use it. Thanks.
Issue, and there are many hospitals now that are having
need three days. And looking at energy efficiency, because almost every place there's a lot that can be done to increase energy efficiency, using LED light bulbs and so on. And, although I understand that it doesn't seem like it's a huge impact for each individual, if every community can actually practice energy efficiency, you make an impact. Thinking about how people get around, employees and patients, whether or not you're bicycle friendly, in terms of just offering facilities for parking bicycles. These little things all add up, but I really suggest that you take a look at Practice Green Health that has a lot more actual recommendations for what healthcare practices can do to reduce their footprints overall.
Good morning. Thank you for sharing. My name is Tim O'Meara, ATS Mutual Medical Student here at the Portland campus. I'm a bit of a pragmatist, so in the event that we don't get the policy and health climate change that we would like to see, what sort of preparations are we making to get ahead of the issue that might show up that you mentioned?
Well, I think we have to do both. And just like the problem is multifaceted, our response has to be multifaceted. So, we ought to be examining our infrastructure and looking at whether or not our infrastructure is going to be able to withstand various climate insults. And that's part of what the GRACE program really is trying to do. But in California, for example, we have an executive order that says essentially when our transportation department is looking at whether they're going to build a new road or repair an existing road, they ought to be thinking about what the forecasts are for sea level rise so that we're not investing a lot of infrastructure in places that are going to be inundated 20 or 30 years from now. We should be looking at whether or not we want to continue zoning for huge new residential developments in places that will not have water or that will be flooded 20 years from now. We ought to be looking at our health infrastructure. So the Pacific Institute, which really studies water issues but is increasingly focused on climate change, did a study a few years ago where they looked at what's the health infrastructure that's threatened by sea level rise in California. They basically mapped hospitals, clinics, skilled nursing facilities, wastewater treatment plants, drinking water treatment facilities, so that people would start thinking about where are we going to put these things? What are we going to do? And then there's also preparations for events. I don't know how many of you have looked at what forecasts are for heat in your own areas and thought about who are the vulnerable populations in our community. Where in the neighborhoods where we're likely to see problems with heat? Because there's people living in poor quality housing without air conditioning, where there's high numbers of elderly people or socially isolated people. Elderly and isolated being two of the biggest risk factors in previous heat waves. Do we have cooling centers? Do we have a way to get vulnerable people to cooling centers? Do our skilled nursing facilities have heat plans in place? What's our heat warning system? So there's a lot of things that we can be doing. And then, of course, where we have urban heat islands, which is areas that become 10 or 12 degrees warmer than surrounding areas because they've got a lot of pavement, a lot of density, a lot of energy use, and not enough green space. What can we do to green those neighborhoods and reduce the amount of heat that we have? So I think there's a ton of things that we can do, and my time is up.
Thank you.